Hi, I'm Andrew Strome, and welcome to a continuation of our series on wood finishing. And today I'm going to talk to you about one of my favorite finishes, which is shellac. Now, shellac was used in India, which is where it originates, as a wood finish for millennia, and in the Western world for a couple of centuries before it got supplanted in the 1920s by synthetic finishes like nitrocellulose lacquer and urethanes. And it fell out of favor for a long time, which is a shame because it really is great stuff. It's quite straightforward and forgiving to work with, and it has a lot of useful properties. In this video, I'm going to walk you through what shellac is and how to work with it successfully and hopefully persuade you to give it a try in your own work. So let's dive in. So shellac is actually a resin secreted by a beetle called the lac bug. And the beetles dwell on plum trees during their larval stage, and they secrete this resin to construct themselves a cocoon. Shellac basically consists of three components. There's the lac resin itself, there's a colorant called lac dye, actually, and in times past, lac dye was actually very valuable as a dye stuff for textiles. And then there is a waxy substance called, not surprisingly, lac wax. Shellac resin, as it's being refined for wood finishing, goes through a purification process. So the resin, as it's collected from the tree, is unsuitable for our purposes. But as it gets refined, the waxy component is removed, and the dye component becomes an even lower and lower proportion of the shellac flakes, which are what we mix up. We dissolve them in alcohol to create a wood finish. This dark shellac, this is called garnet, and you can see that it has a fairly high proportion of that lac dye. And then as we go to my left, we have amber or orange shellac, which is a lighter color. And then we have blonde shellac, which is a very, very light amber tint, not quite colorless. And then there is an even more highly refined grade called super blonde. And all of these various grades of shellac are useful for wood finishing. They simply give you different effects. And I've prepared some sample boards just to give a sense of what the different grades look like on when applied to different woods. And really, it depends on the look that you're after. So I have a piece of birch and a piece of cherry and a piece of walnut. And from the top, I've got the most refined grade, which is the blonde. And then I have amber and garnet. And I'm just going to hold these up, bearing in mind that these boards were not prepared for the purposes of producing a really fine finish, but simply to demonstrate the differences in coloration between the different grades. Birch, you can see that the blonde shellac has only darkened the tone somewhat. And then we have the mid-tone of the amber, and then the darker orange of the garnet. And these darker tones of the shellac, you can see how this would be useful. This property can be useful if you're looking to, as an example, replicate the age of an antique on a lighter wood, or if you simply wish to highlight the natural coloration of certain kinds of woods. So as an example, on this cherry, so here's the blonde, and then we have the amber, which gives you a really nice sort of warm mid-tone, and then the darker garnet. And then on a wood like the walnut, you can see how the garnet in particular really brings out the sort of natural reddish brown, natural coloration of the wood. And with a wood like mahogany or sapele, this would be even more pronounced. Amber shellac really warms up the coloration of the walnut versus the blonde. So as I said, I prepared these just to give a sense of the differences in coloration between the various grades of shellac, but what I wanted to show you is what a properly applied shellac finish looks like. And like most finishes, shellac is best applied in many thin layers rather than thicker ones. So this is bird's eye maple, and this is actually the amber shellac on this entire instrument. And why I used the amber was I really wanted to keep that sort of natural tone of the wood on the bird's eye that I used. And you can see you've got some mineral streaks and some coloration from the heartwood. But in particular, if I turn it over, where using an amber shellac really makes a difference is on the Engelmann spruce top of this instrument. So Engelmann is a really attractive sort of creamy white color. And I didn't want to change that natural coloration of the wood too much. I wanted to deepen it a little bit, but I didn't want to alter the color significantly. So that was the rationale behind my choice of amber. And you can see back and forth in the light a little bit, you can see all these medullary rays, what's called silking in the guitar trade, in this particular top. You can see how they just pop under that shellac finish. Shellac has a number of advantages. It dries quickly because of the alcohol solvent, so it can be recoated within a short space of time. The alcohol also partially dissolves any previous application of the shellac, and so each coat burns into the previous ones so that you don't need to sand between coats. And you also don't need to be as scrupulous about having a dust-free environment as you do with other finishes that take longer to dry, such as a solvent-based varnish. Shellac has decent resistance to water and scratches. It's also quite easy to apply. It can be applied using a number of different methods. You can pat it on, you can brush it on. I brushed on the finish on my guitar. And it can also be sprayed under the right circumstances. Shellac is also useful as a barrier coat. So if you are refinishing something and you're concerned about contamination, maybe you're concerned about wax or silicone on the piece that you're refinishing and you want to finish it with a solvent-based finish, you can apply a barrier coat of shellac to it. And as long as the shellac is de-waxed, that other finish will adhere to the shellac. And finally, shellac is actually quite benign stuff. So yes, the alcohol is toxic. Usually we use denatured alcohol as the solvent, but that is much more benign and safe to work with than some of the other solvents that are used in wood finishing. Here are some watchouts, some things to be aware of when working with shellac. One is that it has a limited shelf life in flake form. When you're storing shellac flakes, it's important to keep them in a completely sealed container. No oxygen, no moisture can get in. The more refined grades, the more expensive grades, of course, have a shorter shelf life than the grades that are less highly refined. And you can tell that flake shellac is past its prime if you go to try and mix up a batch and it doesn't dissolve. You're left with a sort of gelatinous mass at the bottom of the vessel. Of course, if it's got a limited shelf life in flake form, it also has a limited shelf life when mixed, and the same sort of caveat applies. Again, it's a shorter shelf life for the higher, more refined grades, about 6 months or so, and then a year or so for something like a garnet. So best to date your shellac mixes. And if you want to do a test panel always a good policy when you're finishing, just to ensure that the shellac cures properly. If the shellac is too old, what will happen is it will either take a very long time to cure, or it won't cure at all, and you'll be left with a very tacky surface indefinitely. If in doubt, mix up a fresh batch. That's always the safest insurance. Because alcohol is the solvent for shellac, it has very poor resistance to that. And so shellac is a poor choice for something like a dining tabletop or a bar, simply because an accidental spill can potentially damage the finish. The other thing to be aware of is the environment that you're working in. Shellac is best applied in a warm, room temperature, dry environment. If the humidity is too high, particularly if you're working outside in the summer, sometimes water vapor will actually get trapped underneath the shellac and cause something called blushing, which is basically a whitish sort of haze underneath the film. Don't panic if this happens. The solution's easy. Take some pure alcohol and brush that on, just pure solvent. When what that will do is it will soften the film and allow that water to evaporate out of it. The other thing to be aware of with shellac is there's basically only one sheen, right? It's gloss. It's not like other synthetic finishes that come in a variety of sheens. However, this really isn't a disadvantage. Gloss finish is easy to obtain, but if you want something that's semi-gloss or satin, then you can very easily knock back some of that sheen with a woven abrasive pad or even some steel wool. There are a couple of things to be aware of when mixing up shellac. One is to always use a glass container. Shellac is mildly acidic and will actually react with a metal container, and that will turn the shellac black. You can use a proprietary solvent. So this is simply a blend of methanol and isobutyl alcohol. Shellac is mixed in what is called a cut. So because it's an old type of finish, a way of describing the ratio is archaic. So cut is simply the ratio of pounds of shellac resin to gallons of alcohol. You may have heard people referring to a 2-pound cut or a 3-pound cut, and that's simply 2 pounds of resin per gallon of alcohol. Now, a gallon is a lot of shellac. So a simple proportion is about 2 ounces of resin to 1 cup, 8 ounces of alcohol, and that gives you a roughly 2-pound cut. And you can alter those proportions should you require more or less, or if you want a lighter consistency like a 1-pound cut or something heavier such as a 3-pound. So now I'm going to give you a little demonstration on how to apply shellac, just simply using a cloth pad. I have a piece of walnut here, and I'm gonna use some amber shellac. This pad, it's nothing more than some lint-free cotton. I've cut off a piece, I sort of rolled it up like a pastry and then folded it back on itself, and I'm just gripping the two free ends here. So the technique, I'm just gonna walk through it before I actually demonstrate it. So I'm going to come along and land on the piece, brushing along evenly, and then pull off at the end. And I'm going to make a series of very slightly overlapping strokes and recharging the pad as I need to. This is a new one, so it will actually need recharging more often than one that had a little bit of use. I'm not going to go back over areas that I've finished previously. I'm going to let the first coat dry, give it a little scuff sand. The drying will only take a couple of minutes. And what that first coat does is it kind of acts as a sealer. It sets the fibers. We give it a little scuff sand because sometimes the grain raises just a little bit. And then I can go back and apply some more coats. So here we go. Charge it and just remove the excess on the rim of the jar. Bit at the end there that I missed. And this area is probably already dry. It looks uneven, but I'm going to let this first coat flash off and then I'll give it a little scuff sand and we'll apply some more. That initial seal coat dried just in a matter of moments, so I scuff sanded it with some 400 grit. Now I'm going to apply a second coat using exactly the same technique. And I mentioned that these application pads get better the more you use them. You can store them in a jar or a Ziploc bag, and that will prevent the alcohol from evaporating. There's a little bit of a blotch right at the end there. Make a mental note of that if that happens. A subsequent coat of shellac will dissolve that and make that go away, but just make a mental note of that to pay attention to that one particular spot on the next pass. And as I'm going, I can actually squeeze a little bit more shellac out of the center of the pad, and that way I don't have to recharge it. Give it a quick glance in raking light, make sure I didn't miss anywhere. I didn't. So now we'll let this third coat dry. I'm going to apply one final coat to this piece. And again, sort of looking at it in raking light. Raking light is your friend when finishing, because it helps you see any spots that you've missed. I mentioned that shellac has decent water resistance. That's not to say that you can use it on something that's going to be exposed to outdoor conditions. Shellac really is strictly an indoor kind of finish, but as I said, it's tremendously versatile stuff. And can be used for a whole range of projects, from furniture to things like small boxes and musical instruments, as I showed you. So the total elapsed time for applying four coats of shellac to this piece of walnut has only been about 20 minutes. From here, I would let this one dry thoroughly. And then depending on what kind of effect I wanted, if I wanted to cut it back a little bit, I might use a fine abrasive pad like a Merlon, a 2500 grit or something like that. And if I wanted to provide a little bit of additional protection against accidental spills or abrasion, I might apply a coating of paste wax. And again, depending on how much sheen you want, you might use a wax that's got something like a carnauba in it for a glossy finish, or something that it has a higher proportion of beeswax for a semi-gloss. I mentioned earlier that shellac's got decent moisture resistance. That's not to say, though, that it's for projects that will be exposed to outdoor conditions. It's really an indoor kind of finish, but as you've seen, it's tremendously versatile stuff for everything from furniture to small boxes to musical instruments. So there you have it, an overview of shellac, where it comes from, and how to work with it successfully. Thanks very much for joining us, and we'll see you next time.